So a little bit about the speaker. She did her master's from Charles University, Prague, Czech Republic, and her PhD degree from École Normale Supérieure de Cachan in Rennes, France. And now currently she is a professor in Bielefeld University. And her field of interest, research interests are stochastic and rough PDEs, stochastic analysis, rough paths, conservation laws and degenerate parabolic SPDEs, and regularity and fluid mechanics. And we are very happy she's here with us for 2 weeks to give this short course on this.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, and also many thanks for the invitation. I'm very happy that I could make it here and that I could present you part of my work. So, as you heard, I'm interested in fluid dynamics and in SPDEs. And recently we wrote a book together with Eduard Feireisel, whom you may also know, and together with Dominic Bright. So I would like to present to you some of the results and methods that you can find in that book. And the book concerns stochastic Navier Stokes system for compressible fluids. Maybe you know something about a deterministic Navier-Stokes system, maybe even for compressible fluids, that would be very helpful. But I would like to start somehow slowly, and maybe not everybody is really familiar with stochastic PDEs, stochastic integration, and the probability theory that we need to treat these equations. So I would like to start slowly and introduce first the stochastic Itô integral. So this will be the content of the lecture definitely today, maybe tomorrow. It will be somehow a quick overview. Yeah, I will not do any proofs because I prefer to move to the stochastic Navier-Stokes system, but feel free to ask questions. We can also make the lectures flexible, so if you want to see a proof something or some further discussion, just let me know. Yeah, I would be happy to do that. But as it is planned for the moment, it would be somehow an overview without proofs to give you some ideas. Because also I understood that somebody is already familiar with the stochastic Itô integration, at least one, but more. Yeah, so but we can make it flexible. So just let me know if you have any wishes and any questions. You can interrupt me anytime. Okay. So what do we want to do? I would like to make sense of the following picture. Let me put here an integral from 0 to little t. Here I would have some integrand phi, which depends on s, dws. Now what w for me is, it will be a Brownian motion. And let us think here about the one-dimensional Brownian motion. So probably all of you have a picture in mind what this really is, at least the meaning of that, or what does it model. So it's this chaotic movement of particles. Yeah, it is described by a stochastic process. Maybe I could also write down the definition, or does everybody know the definition? Shall I write it? Who votes yes? Thank you very much. So a Wiener process, W, it is a stochastic process, meaning I have some probability space on which everything happens. So this is a set omega, there is a sigma algebra F, and there is a probability measure P. And W is a stochastic process. So what does a stochastic process actually mean? Well, it is a mapping which depends on time. Somehow capture some events that happen as the time evolves. And let me write it this way. So for every time, this is a measurable mapping, and we take it here real valued. Yeah, this would be now for every time, and we can do every time bigger equal to zero. So this is generally what a stochastic process means. For every t, it should be a measurable mapping. It takes values in some function space. Here, for simplicity, it will be just real valued. Okay, but of course, this is not enough. So there are some more properties, which I write down now. The first property is the process should start from zero. So nothing happens at the time zero, W at zero is just simply zero. Yeah, and I still give myself the freedom to say here it's zero, P almost surely. Somehow everything here will kind of happen P almost surely because we don't really care about the zero measure sets. Yeah, so this is the first property. The second property is what kind of regularity do we require with respect to this parameter t. Now let me write here, so if I fix omega in omega, then w, the mapping that takes t and gives me w t omega, this is what we call a trajectory. Yeah, so for one fixed omega, I have a mapping only of time. This is a trajectory of the Brownian motion. And now the question is, what kind of regularity do I ask, or what actually I can expect from this process, from this trajectory? Yeah, so here in the definition, I only require that it is continuous. So W has continuous trajectories. And again, I can write P almost surely. Yeah, so for almost every omega, this mapping is continuous. Okay, there is the next property. And this is already something probabilistic. We say that W has independent increments. Okay, so what do I mean by that? Yeah, so increments means increments in time, which means I look at the differences w at some time tn minus w at tn minus 1. Yeah, and I can do many of them. I take some partition, and here wt, let's say t2 minus wt1. And so these are time increments where I have chosen some times, let's say 0, I can do t1, t2, etc. Yeah. So these are the so-called increments, time increments of the Brownian motion. And now if you think about it, what are these objects here? There is still the dependence on omega. So omega is the randomness variable. And that means these guys, these increments, they are random variables. Yeah, and this is what the word independent here then characterizes. I want them to be independent random variables. Random variables for every such sequence of times. Okay, so this is a very important property. And there is one more. This is also a probabilistic statement, namely for every time s t bigger or equal to 0, and I take s smaller than t for simplicity, then I want to ask myself, what is the probability law of this increment? Yeah, so you know, it's a random variable, so it generates a probability measure on the sigma algebra. And now the question is, what is this probability measure? Yeah, and as a part of the definition, I postulate, so I use this little twiddle, or sometimes I put D as in distribution there. So this has the law of the normal Gaussian distribution with expected value 0, and the variance t minus s. Yeah, so this is now a definition of a process. Okay, we can somehow digest that, but the question is, well, what follows from the definition, right? Because our goal that we keep in mind is to construct some integral with respect to the Brownian motion. Yeah, and okay, what kind of stands here? You could kind of also write it maybe like this. It's like having their dt of w at s ds. Yeah, so it kind of suggests that you would need w to be differentiable. And so maybe our very first question is it differentiable? Can we, because if it was differentiable, then we're good. We can just define the picture, the integral like this, and we're good. Yeah. Or if we knew that the W had trajectories of bounded variation. Yeah, you remember here I have postulated that the trajectories are continuous, but maybe we know more, maybe we can prove more. And if that was the case, if the trajectories were of finite variation, then you know how to construct this integral. This is a Lebesgue-Hilties integral, and we don't have any problem. Yeah, but actually, in that case, we wouldn't have to do any probability, and the life would be a bit boring. So I can tell you some properties of the Brownian motion that follow from the definition, and they're kind of puzzling, and they will show us that actually, it's not so obvious how to define such an integral. And it's not even clear at the moment whether we can do that. Yeah, I mean, for sure we cannot do this, at least in generally, unless phi has some regularity. Yeah, so we need to find a better way. So the properties that we can prove for the trajectories of the Brownian motion are the following. So the question is, are they of finite variation? Well, are they maybe even differentiable? The answer is no. So the trajectories is almost surely nowhere differentiable. Okay, so this is something we can easily imagine. There are functions that are just not differentiable. And therefore, well, we don't know how to define the integral. But there are some further kind of fun facts about the Brownian motion, which I find really puzzling. So another one is, if you look at the points of the local maximum of these trajectories. So again, I look at this mapping, and now I look at points of local maximum. So somehow where it reaches a maximum, then there has to be again a minimum somewhere, etc. But the point is that these points of local maximum are dense in zero infinity. So that's kind of for very many times it has a local maximum. So that's already somehow crazy to imagine, right? And again, it's almost surely, so there is somehow the probability plays the role. So almost surely dense and countable. Yeah, let's say in zero infinity. So it's kind of a trajectory that has pretty much everywhere a maximum. And we can say a little bit more about these points of maximum. Namely, the maximum values are pairwise different. Again, almost surely. Yeah, so it kind of has everywhere a maximum, but these values of the maximum are different from each other. Okay, and well, so what we can then say is that it has an unbounded variation. So unbounded variation on every time interval. Yeah, so whenever I choose AB to be a time interval, almost surely the variation of the Brownian motion is not finite on that interval. Yeah, so no matter how short the interval is, so that somehow tells us that the Brownian motion has to oscillate very much. Yeah, this is the picture that we get out of these statements. So we have understood that finite variation is somehow not good for the Brownian motion, but maybe there is some regularity. And the question is, can we maybe speak about Helder continuity? And indeed we can. The trajectories are Helder continuous almost surely for an exponent alpha strictly smaller than 1/2. And this is really sharp in the sense, if alpha is 1/2, then the Brownian motion does not have trajectories with that Helder continuity. And so you see there is in fact some regularity. Third one, the maximum values are pairwise different almost surely. So what I mean by that is, if you look at two different local maxima, and I mean at the value that it attains in these local maxima, they're different. Yeah, so it's somehow many different values, but still it's somehow maximum almost everywhere. Other questions? Okay, so we see there is some regularity, so maybe not everything is totally lost. Okay, this is indeed what will help us eventually. Yeah, but still we need to use some probability. So the punchline of all this is, if you want to construct such an integral with respect to the Brownian motion, well, analytical tools are not enough. Yeah, so it's not sufficient to work with analysis. Because maybe going back to my second attempt here, we can still think about it, right? Because, well, so if we think about defining such an object. Yeah, maybe it's not so bad because, well, we understood that the trajectories are Helder continuous. Okay, so this is a time derivative of a Helder continuous function, which means this is a distribution. So somehow one could speak of regularity of, let's say, -1/2. So it's a derivative of something which is almost one half Helder. So maybe let me write it this way, -1/2 -ε. So if my Brownian motion is 1/2 -ε Helder, then its time derivative must have regularity one level below. Okay, and so now that means it is a distribution and it is an honest distribution. It is really not a function. Yeah, and now you maybe go back to some functional analysis course and you ask yourself the question, well, I could multiply distributions with test functions. Yeah. So you may think, okay, if this guy is a test function, meaning it has a sufficient regularity, I can actually make sense of this product, I mean, in this duality. Yeah. And indeed, you can do that. Here, the condition that you need is, so if this one has regularity beta, then the condition for this to be well defined in principle. Would be beta -1/2 -ε. So this is the sum of the two regularities. It should be basically bigger equal to zero. If I speak only about the product without the duality, then I would have strict inequality here. But if I speak somehow together with the duality, then also equality is good. Yeah, so in principle, in order to multiply two distributions, you need that the sum of their regularities is strictly positive. If I speak really only about the product, not the duality, so not include the integral. Okay, and this is really now a good idea. So if this function phi is regular enough, coming from this condition, then the integral is really well defined as a duality product. Yeah, and then we are actually done. So why do we need to worry with probability, actually? Because here, under this condition, we don't need any probability. This is really just analysis, and you can make sense of this product. Yeah, the reason why probability kicks in is that eventually I want to solve a stochastic differential equation. And so I ask myself, what is this process phi, and what regularity can I actually expect from it? And now, well, to give you a little heads up, eventually I would like to study the Navier-Stokes system. Let me write it down. Yeah, so this is now the, okay, there is of course the divergence free constraint and some initial condition, but this is the Navier-Stokes system for compressible fluids. You recognize the convective term, the pressure, the viscous term, and I would like to include some stochastic perturbation. Yeah, this would include some uncertainty, for instance, or it could serve as a model of turbulence, and I would like to do it actually even more interesting. I would like to allow here for a dependence on the solution. Yeah. So what it means now is that here I would like to have a parameter or a coefficient that depends on my solution. Yeah. Let's say phi does not depend on time. It only depends on time through my solution u. And we can now go back to the question here, what is the expected regularity of this guy? Okay, so for me, here it would be phi of u, and what is the expected time regularity? Yeah, so maybe I should also say, this is the way we write stochastic PDEs, meaning this with this d here, dt, but to be in the ODE setting, you can just imagine dividing everything formally by dt, and you have really the time derivative here, this one vanishes, this one vanishes, this one vanishes, and here you have kind of the time derivative of the Brownian motion. Now, so this is just a formal way of writing things, but still I have to tell you how to make sense of this guy, and this is what we are now working on. Yeah, but back to the question, what is the expected time regularity here? In other words, what is the expected time regularity of my solution u? Now, because this is really what I should understand, this would then transfer to the time regularity of this object. And so now if you think about it again a little bit more, it is kind of like time derivative of u. Okay, there are some other terms. It is kind of proportional to, let's say, something which is maybe not that bad, which is nice, and there is time derivative of the Brownian motion. Yeah, and in a special case you can maybe even forget this guy, right? And then really time derivative of u is kind of proportional to the time derivative of the Brownian motion, meaning it cannot have better regularity than the Brownian motion itself. Yeah, so really the even simplified version is I just forget this one, and then you can guess that the regularity of u in time would be the same of the Brownian motion. Okay, and so what that means is that I'm below 1/2. Yeah, so I somehow expect that u would have regularity 1/2 minus epsilon. So it is a Helder function, but yeah, not very much regular. And now from that I can deduce that also my phi of u, if I have nice properties of the function phi, so this would have now regularity, let's say, the same. Now this is what we can guess, but of course then later we need to prove it. And this is what I want to have here inside my stochastic integral. And so you see that actually if I put here 1/2 minus epsilon minus 1/2 minus epsilon, this is strictly negative. Yeah, so you see that our condition is not satisfied. In other words, I need to use it for functions or processes phi that don't have sufficient time regularity to be able to define this guy by just by mathematical analysis. Yeah, so somehow mathematical analysis doesn't help us anymore because it just cannot work. Yeah, so this is what we understood now. And of course the question is we have to do something else. Yeah, and this is precisely the point where probability kicks in. And somehow probability is like it offers us a helping hand and we can use some tools from probability theory in order to make sense of the stochastic integral and then later on to treat, to solve these stochastic Navier-Stokes equations. So far we have understood that, okay, there is a need of something, some non-trivial argument coming from outside of analysis, because analysis somehow cannot give us more. Okay. And the main probability tool that we use here is the notion of a martingale. Does somebody hear about martingales? I will recall the definition anyway. Okay. So what is it, a martingale? So a stochastic process, let me call it M, is a, okay, sorry, I forgot to tell you one other definition, so I have to do that first. Okay, sorry. Yes. So what we are going to use is martingale theory, and in addition, there is a price to pay. So there will be some further conditions on this integrand here to be able to make sense of the stochastic integral. Yeah. And one of these conditions is the so-called arrow of time. So the time goes forward, we cannot look backwards. And this is represented by the following concept. Ft for t bigger or equal to zero, this is a family of sub sigma algebras of my sigma algebra F here. Yeah. It is the so-called filtration. A family of sub sigma fields of F. With the following condition, it is a non-decreasing family. Meaning that if S is smaller than T, then also this is a sub-sigma algebra of Ft. S smaller to T. Okay. So now this filtration, this allows us to capture the evolution of time on our probability space omega. Yeah. In principle, what is an example of such a filtration? I already have my Brownian motion, so I can define, for instance, Ft of the Brownian motion is the sigma field generated by the Brownian motion, but only of by these random variables for s smaller or equal to t. So this defines a filtration. What does that mean? Well, it means I take all these functions WS, they're functions of omega, yeah, and I look at the sets that they, at the family of sets that they generate on omega. Yeah, so maybe to recall, WS is a mapping from omega with the sigma algebra to the real numbers with the Borel sigma algebra. Yeah, and so what this means, I take basically all the pre-images omega s to minus 1 of all these set A Borel in R. So I take all the pre-images here and I create a sigma algebra out of them. In other words, this sigma algebra FTW captures all the events that happen to the Brownian motion up to the time t. Yeah, so in this sense, it captures the evolution of time of the Brownian motion itself. Yeah? So you see, this really sees all the events up to time t, and nothing more can happen to the Brownian motion up to time t. Okay, and what we will require from this process phi is that it, in a certain sense, respects this time evolution. Yeah, it cannot look into the future. It can only see the past of the Brownian motion. So for this, I need two additional concepts. One concept is the adaptedness. So a stochastic process is FT adapted. This means, okay, a stochastic process, let me call it maybe somehow general X. If X at time t is FT measurable. Yeah, so at every time it is measurable with respect to the correct sigma algebra. Yeah, for instance, it cannot see the future. It only sees the present time. And actually, since FT kind of is bigger than all the previous ones, it can see the past. Yeah, so this is one requirement that we will need, but actually this is still not enough for the construction of the stochastic integral. So I have to go one step further and to introduce the notion of progressive measurability. So it is a process is FT progressively measurable if the following mapping, so if I take the interval from 0 to little t cross omega, and then I go to R, so this is the mapping that takes S and omega, and give me the value of the stochastic process S omega. Yeah, so you see, here I see only times up to little t. And I want to include the corresponding time evolution also on the space omega. So the requirement is, can everybody see it? Yes. That this is b 0 t o times ft measurable. And so the sigma algebra that I can choose here is, here I have the Borel set, so that somehow clear and obvious, but the point is this one. So also on the probability space omega, I don't look into the future. Yeah, I see only the current current sigma algebra FT. Okay, and so now you see there is a lot of measure theory. Now maybe it's not really so obvious why I bother you with all this. So the point is, there is really a price to pay, and I want to somehow make you feel that it really does not come for free to define such a stochastic integral. One really has to do something non-trivial. And okay, that's why we have to bother with this measure theory here. Yeah, but somehow a good news is that checking adaptedness is not difficult. And if the process is adapted and has continuous trajectories, actually right continuous is enough, then it is progressively measurable. Yeah, so somehow we never have to use any fancy measure theory to really prove that something is progressively measurable. Yeah, so this is what I just said. Adapted plus right continuous trajectories implies progressively measurable. And this is really what we will need. So in particular, we will need some other conditions, but one very important condition is that this integrand here is progressively measurable. Yeah, so somehow there is this arrow of time, we cannot forget it. Yeah, but then in applications, we need to check that condition, of course, to make sure that the stochastic integral is well defined. But the point is, adaptiveness will be easy to prove, and we will prove some kind of time continuity. So we are good to go. But it's somehow good to keep that in mind, that it's really, yeah, somehow there is some non-trivial arguments needed. Okay, are there some questions now? Okay, so with these definitions, I can proceed to the definition of a martingale. So martingale is again a notion which is very important for the stochastic integration theory. So I promise very soon everything will somehow join together and it will make sense. Yeah, we just need this one more thing. So what is it, a martingale? It's again a stochastic process. Call it M for martingale is an FT martingale. Yeah, so as before, FT is a filtration. It's some general filtration. So it is a martingale if, and we have several conditions here again. The first one is easy. This is what we already know. It is FT adapted. Yeah, so this is what we just explained. So what that means is that M at time t is measurable with respect to the sigma algebra FT. Cannot see the future. Okay. The second condition is also easy. This is just integrability. So expectation of the absolute value of MT. So expectation is the average with respect to my probability measure P, and it should be finite for every t. So I want things to be integrable. And the third condition is the most important one. This is the so-called martingale property, which tells me that the conditional expectation of M at time t given a sigma algebra F, let's say at time s, this is equal to ms. Almost surely, whenever s is smaller or equal to t. Yeah, so this is the martingale property. Which means if you condition your process at time t by all the knowledge of what happens up to time s, this expected value is m at time s. So again, it is some kind of, it cannot see into the future. notion. Okay, so with these definitions, I have a little exercise for you. Namely, what you can try to prove is that the Brownian motion is a martingale, and the question is, of course, what filtration with respect to its canonical filtration. So this is the filtration W, FWT. This is what I defined over there. Yeah, and so this is what I claim, and this is what you can then check during the lunch break. And let me know if you have questions. Yeah, so we have the definition of a Brownian motion. We have a definition of a martingale. Now I want you, we have a definition also of this filtration, and I want you to prove that Brownian motion is a martingale with respect to that filtration. Yeah, so you can take a look at that later. It's actually just a simple computation working with these conditional expectations. Okay, so once we have that, I would like to state a theorem which gives us a very important property of martingales that we will then use for, actually for the Navier-Stokes system to construct solutions. Okay, so I take a martingale. Let M be a square integrable martingale. So what do I mean by square integrable? Just that the expectation of the square is finite. So this is okay. And again, the question now is about the regularity of the trajectory. So the regularity with respect to time. Yeah, you see, for Brownian motion is one example of a martingale. So you see, in generally, there cannot be a statement like every martingale has regular trajectories. That cannot be possible because Brownian motion is one of the examples. And we have already seen that it does not have nice trajectories. It oscillates really very much. Yeah, and so the question is, what can we say now generally for all martingales? What we can say is it has finite quadratic variation. And I will explain what this means. Then it has finite quadratic variation. Okay, so what that means is the following. Namely, there exists an increasing process, an increasing, even continuous stochastic process, and I call it M in these brackets. So again, it depends on time. It is a stochastic process, and it is given by the following limit. So we can compute it at time t by the limit in probability. So this is what I use as a notation for limit in probability. Yeah, and the limit, let's say as n goes to infinity, of the following expression. I take a sum, then I have some time points in a partition, and I look at increments of this process m. So m at the time t I plus 1 minus m t I, and I take it to the power 2. Yeah, so the power 2 is here because we are looking for quadratic variation. And I should still tell you what is this delta n. It is a partition of and of the interval 0 little t. So let's say I have 0 is equal T naught smaller than T1. Smaller, etc. And then the last one would be okay. TKN. Yeah, I think you understand what I mean. So I want to take a partition of the interval 0 to t. And I want to take a partition with vanishing mesh size. So this is the mesh size, meaning maximum of ti plus 1 minus ti. And this goes to 0. So I take a partition, a sequence of partitions with vanishing mesh size, and now I look at the increment here. We spoke about finite variation. So you know finite variation means I have absolute value here and no square. But that does not work because the variation cannot be finite, as we have the Brownian motion as an example. But somehow maybe if we make these increments even smaller by putting the square, then there is a hope to making maybe this one somehow converging. And indeed, this converges in probability. So again, it's not pathwise, it is in probability. This is one statement. So there exists such a process. So actually the quadratic variation is finite. And additional, moreover, what can we say about this new process is the following. If I take m square, and I ask myself whether this process is a martingale. So what does that mean? I have m, which is a martingale, and now I take its square, and I ask myself, is it maybe also a martingale? The answer is no, in general, but we can correct it. Namely, if I use the quadratic variation here, this one is a martingale. Continuous martingale. Okay, so actually this quadratic variation is, in a sense, a corrector. Corrector of the process M square to make it a martingale. What I also want to say is that this quadratic variation actually has a finite variation than itself. So it has better time regularity. And so this theorem tells us that this process exists and it has this nice property. As a consequence, what we can do also, if I take two processes, Mn, and they are both square integrable martingales, I can define what is called their cross variation. Cross variation process as follows. So I denote it this way, again evaluated at time t. So this is a cross variation of these two martingales. And I can just define it by 1 over 4 m plus n, quadratic variation of that, m minus n, again the quadratic variation of that. Not much has happened right now. Of course I can define this thing. The question is, what properties does it satisfy? You can check also as an exercise, if I have two square integrable martingales, then m plus n is also a square integrable martingale. This you can also check later. So you just check all the properties of that definition. And you know that this conditional expectation is linear. Very similarly, m minus n is also a square integrable martingale. Therefore, this quadratic variation here makes sense, and this one as well, by my theorem. And so I can define this one But that still doesn't tell us much, so let me write as a conclusion. What I can also prove is that there is a similar formula for as this one, yeah, for the cross variation. Yeah, and now you can guess how what I should write. So again, there would be a limit somehow over points in the partition, in some partition. And what should I write here? You could guess to make it really consistent. Somehow, if m and n are the same, I want to end up with the quadratic variation. Yeah? You can also check that this is consistent with this formula here, if they are the same. Yeah, basically, because m plus m would be two of them, and this is quadratic, so I get actually four out of it, and this cancels my four here. Yeah, and here I get zero. Yeah. Okay, so the consistent way here is mt I plus 1 minus mti nti plus 1 minus nti. Yeah, and so you see that it's really consistent, namely m cross variation with m is just the quadratic variation. Yeah. And also there is an analogy of this statement here. Yeah, in other words, the cross variation is also a kind of corrector. Namely, if I look at the product m times n minus the cross variation, this is again a continuous martingale. Okay. So these are some basic definitions and basic results that we will use heavily then for the Navier-Stokes system. Yeah, but maybe the question for now to understand these things a little better is the following. I mean, what is the quadratic variation of the Brownian motion? Right, because we have our one example of a martingale. And then this theorem tells us that the quadratic variation exists, but okay, what is it? Do we have a formula for that? Can we compute it? So the next exercise is the following. You should show that W squared t minus t. So this is now a process which takes t and gives me, I hope this is very readable. So the stochastic process, which takes t and gives me w square at time t minus t, is a martingale, again with respect to the canonical filtration, yeah, this FW. Okay, so this is what you can also look at during the coffee break, during the lunch later. And this actually tells you already what the quadratic variation of the Brownian motion is. Yeah, because what I didn't say is that there is only a unique process, there is just one, this corrector. So there is just one quadratic variation. This is what you can see from here. Yeah, it cannot converge to another limit, right? There cannot be two limits. So we see this process is unique. And therefore, to find the quadratic variation of the Brownian motion, it is enough to find the corrector. Namely, to find the process here so that the W square minus that process is a martingale. Yeah, so actually once you prove that this is a martingale, you deduce that the quadratic variation of W at time t is equal to t. Yeah, so that's actually very nice. In particular, because the left-hand side depends on omega. Yeah, this is a random variable. It depends on omega. In principle, this is what we would guess. But we see that the right-hand side does not depend on omega. In other words, also the left-hand side does not depend on omega. But what I wanted to say is that in general, this is really a stochastic process. This depends on omega. It's just that for the Brownian motion, we are in this very special situation where it is actually deterministic. Okay, and so now I would like to proceed to the construction of the stochastic integral. Actually, I think you will find it not very surprising because it's very similar to the construction of the Lebesgue integral. You remember probably how the Lebesgue integral is constructed. You start with simple functions or step functions. There you know what the integral has to be. And okay, then you extend this by some limiting procedure. And this is precisely what we are going to do here. So in that sense, the construction of the stochastic integral is not very surprising. But still, there are some non-trivial features, as we have already understood. Okay, so what I want to say is the following. The stochastic Itô integral let me use the same notation, phi dw. So what is it? It is a martingale. Which satisfies certain properties. Okay, now let me call it this way. I of W phi is just the integral phi dw. So basically at time t, this is now an integral from 0 to t. Okay, and so this is a martingale, so that, and the first condition is, what value does it take at 0? Yeah, so what is this process at time equals 0? And again, you can have a guess. What would be somehow the reasonable thing to postulate here? Well, you know, integral from 0 to 0, you would like it to be 0. So we postulate that this process at time 0 is equal to 0. Yeah, and the second condition that I postulate is the following. I write it down and then I explain. So for every continuous martingale M, we have the following. So it holds, okay, almost surely, that now if I look at the cross variation of this martingale and my stochastic integral, the cross variation at time t. Yeah, now we have to make sure that everything makes sense. So the cross variation is defined for square integrable martingales. Yeah, so I should assume the square integrability here, I think. Yeah, and actually we will see that the stochastic integral itself is also square integrable. But I think I have to put it here in the definition. Just, yeah, to have the quadratic variation. Okay, how should this look like? So it should be an integral from 0 to t, phi at time s, d, and what I write here is now the cross variation of m and w at time s. Okay, so this may look strange at first sight, right? Because you would ask yourself, now what is this? do we know how to define that guy? So for instance, if M was W, we know that here we would have the quadratic variation of W, which we know what it is. Yeah. So let's say if M is equal to W, what we deduce from this is that the cross variation of W and the stochastic integral with respect to W, this is equal to the integral from 0 to t phi s ds. And you see, this is a nice integral. This is a Lebesgue integral, and we know how to construct it. So this is OK. Yeah, now, the question is whether for a general martingale, this process has a finite variation. If it does, then this is just the usual Lebesgue-Stieltjes integral. And indeed, I have mentioned it for the quadratic variation, that it has a finite variation. So we cannot really see it here, but this can be proved. So this process has a finite variation. As a consequence, this the cross variation also has to have a finite variation. Because this one has finite variation, this one as well. Their sum has finite variation. And so finally, we arrive at the point where we can say that this cross variation is a process of finite variation. So this is really the usual Lebesgue-Stieltjes integral, which we can define. Yeah, so for this, we don't need any probability, actually, to construct this integral. Yeah. OK. So this is what can be taken as a definition of the stochastic Itô integral. Of course, the very first question that you should now ask me is, well, why does such a thing even exist? Because, well, that's not obvious, right? And moreover, under which conditions does it exist? I probably need some assumptions on this process phi. Yeah, and so this is what we are going to figure out now. Under what conditions on phi does such a process exist? Yeah, and why does it satisfy these properties? Okay, and as I told you, it is very similar to the construction of the Lebesgue integral. We want to start with step functions. What replaces step functions here are elementary processes. Okay, so that means basically processes that are piecewise constant. So if I have some partition t naught, t1, etc. till tk, so I would like to construct a stochastic integral on the interval 0 capital T. And I take some partition, and let me draw a picture. Somehow I want to, so there would be 0 capital T. I have some partition here, T1, etc. Yes. And I want it to be piecewise constant. So that means here it would have some value, let's say phi naught. Here there will be some different value, phi 1. Here something, etc. Yeah. And now we should not forget the randomness variable. In general, what I would like to integrate are really stochastic processes. So they do not only depend on time, they also depend on the randomness. Yeah. And this has to be reflected already here in a definition of elementary processes. Namely, I want to give myself the freedom to have the omega dependence. In other words, these phi naught, they should be random variables themselves. So they can additionally depend on omega. Let phi 0 till phi k minus 1 be random variables. So they depend on omega. And I have already gave you a hint that there is somehow this arrow of time. Yeah, some of the processes cannot look into the future. And this also has to be reflected already on this elementary level. And this is done as follows through some measurability. So I postulate that phi L is FTL measurable. Okay, L is 0, etc. till k minus 1. And this is now a very important point. Namely, what is really important is the sigma algebra that I have chosen here. You see, for instance, if L is equal to 0, I am on this interval, and I have phi naught. And now I say that it should be measurable with respect to the sigma algebra FT naught, which is just F0, 0. So somehow here at time 0, I have my F0. And phi naught has to be measurable with respect to that sigma algebra. Yeah, so really, I take the left point of the interval. The process will have the constant value phi naught on this little interval, but everything has to be measurable with respect to the left point. Yeah, so f at time 0, and here I have the same measurability. So this is really important, and this is what will guarantee that this process is progressively measurable. I mean, I still didn't tell you what is the process, but from the picture you already have a guess. So I finally define my process phi at time t. Or what is this? Well, it should be these constants. So phi l, if the time t belongs to the interval tl, tl plus 1. So this is precisely how I define it. And this is what we call an elementary stochastic process. Yeah, and maybe something that you can again think about, another exercise. I said that I will need the integrands. So this process is phi. I will need them to be progressively measurable. Now you remember there was this measure theoretic definition of that notion, but then I said there is a simple criterion if a process is adapted and has right continuous trajectories. And so the little exercise that you can think about here is to say that phi, which is defined here, so this is this process, this one, the elementary process, phi is FT progressively measurable. Yeah, so this is what you can think about then later. And now, of course, exactly as when you constructed the Lebesgue integer, you also have a guess what should the stochastic integer be here. Right? So here I can really define a stochastic integer as follows. So the integer from 0 to t phi s dws, what should I write here? So the process is piecewise constant. Maybe somebody has an idea. Yeah, what if we think about a Lebesgue integral for step functions? How was that defined? Yes, exactly. Thank you very much. Yeah, here is really somehow the natural thing that you would expect. So let's say the sum from L equals 0 to k minus 1. And then on each of these little intervals, I have the value phi L, and I have to multiply this by the increment of the Brownian motion, meaning W T L plus 1. And I take here minimum T because I integrate only up to T. Yeah, but I have the partition up to capital T. So I have to take the minimum here minus W T L minimum T. And this is now for time in the interval 0, capital T. Yeah, so this is really now something that makes sense. I can write it down, and the advantage is you see that as the process is constant on each of these intervals, I don't see any time derivative of the Brownian motion, yeah, where I would have a problem. So now I just see an increment, and this is well defined. So what we see in this case of elementary processes is really well defined. And now exactly as for the Lebesgue integral, what we would like to do, we would like to take a general stochastic process in a certain class, and we would like to show that it's possible to approximate it by such elementary integrals. Yeah, then we know how these stochastic integrals of elementary processes look like. And the question is whether there is a limit. Yeah, so we have to prove that there is a limit. And this limit would then be our general stochastic integral. Okay. I leave this. So now I would like to extend this definition to a general process. And I mean, the question is still, how general can this process be? So let phi be progressively measurable. This is what I will need to make everything work. Progressively measurable stochastic process so that it has certain integrability. Expectation of the integral from 0 to t phi at time s to the power 2 ds is finite. Okay, maybe let me put here capital T. Yeah, so these are the conditions under which I can construct the stochastic integral. Now, maybe one more comment on this progressive measurability. Maybe it is not really clear why we need that. But if you think about the definition of the stochastic integral, which was here, unfortunately, I erased everything. So what was the definition? Well, we said it is a stochastic process, but not only that, it should be a martingale. Yeah, and so in other words, we have to prove the martingale property of this term, of the right-hand side, right? Because, I mean, already for the setting of an elementary process, I want to prove that it satisfies the definition of a stochastic integral. Yeah, so maybe you can take this as another exercise, and then please let me know if there are questions, really. Check that this integral is a martingale. Yeah. And you will figure out that you need some measurability condition. Namely, you need this one. Yeah. So you need this measurability to prove the martingale property. So also in the general case, well, we require the progressive measurability in order to be able to prove the martingale property. Yeah, and then we have the second condition. So the process basically, if you like this notation more, I can say that the process belongs to L2 of omega times 0 capital T. Yeah, plus the progressive measurability. And I need this second condition in order to be able to approximate by simple elementary processes. Okay, so I will somehow just do a summary of how this goes. You can also think about the proofs, or everything can be found. For instance, what I like very much is the Book of Baldi. Something like, yeah, stochastic analysis or stochastic calculus or something like that. Stochastic, maybe calculus. Let me know if you cannot find it. And in our book, I think we also recall somehow the definition of the stochastic integral and some further discussion. So that would be then Bright, Feyerabend, and myself, stochastically forced compressible fluids. So this is the literature where you can find more. This is really a textbook on probability theory, stochastic integration, etc. So there are also exercises. It's really very nice. Here, there is a chapter on stochastic analysis, somehow the basics of stochastic analysis, where we discuss also, if I remember correctly, the construction of the Itô integral. Okay, but to conclude, so under these conditions, there exists a sequence phi n of elementary processes which approximate my process phi exactly in this L2 sense, namely the integral, the expectation integral from 0 to capital T phi n s minus phi s square ds goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. Yeah, so these are elementary processes. For those, I have a stochastic integral. And moreover, I have this convergence. And so now the question is whether the corresponding stochastic integrals of phi n against w actually converge also. Yeah, and this is really the key of the stochastic analysis. This is the so-called Itô isometry. And the Itô isometry is the following statement, which tells me that the expectation of the square of, let's do up to capital T, that the square of a stochastic integral of an element, let me put n here, of an, let me do it this way, or let me do tilde, is equal to the expectation integral from 0 to capital T, and here phi tilde square dt for every elementary process. So eventually one proves that actually for every process in this class. But first we only know what the stochastic integral is for elementary processes. Yeah, and it turns out that one could really prove this expression. So what does that mean? Well, here I have a square of the stochastic integral. And if you think about it, well, it's like I want to put the square inside, right? This is what I then have here. And so if you think of a Lebesgue integral, or if you think of having W not a Brownian motion, but something of finite variation, you can do some Helder inequality, for instance. Yeah, but you would get an inequality. And here this is like really some kind of martingale magic that we see. We get even an equality. we are able to put the square inside the integral, we get an equality, and I mean, this is also not a coincidence. What here stands is really the quadratic variation of W. Yeah, but we have seen that the quadratic variation of W is just T, so W at time T. Yeah, and so this is the Itô isometry. And now you already see why this is really very nice for us, because we know that our elementary processes converge in this L2 omega cross zero time, zero capital T sense. And this is precisely the norm that I get here. So I could apply the Itô isometry for elementary process, which would be, let's say, phi. I want to prove that the sequence of stochastic integrals is Cauchy. So I could do phi n minus phi m. Yeah, each of them is an elementary process, so the difference is also an elementary process. Therefore, I can apply the Itô isometry, and what I get is here, again, you can check that, okay, no tilde, this is one stochastic integral minus the other one. Yeah, you can check that the stochastic integral is linear with respect to the integrand, and I use my Itô isometry, integral from 0 to t, and here I have phi n minus phi m to the power 2 dt. And since I have this convergence here, I know that the right-hand side goes to 0. As a consequence, also the left-hand side goes to 0, and it really gives me a convergence of the stochastic integral. So if I now take it up to capital T, phi n dw converges to something which I call here phi dw in, and what is the sense, L2 of omega. Yeah, so this is really how the stochastic integral is constructed from the elementary processes. Yeah, I did it here for only for one fixed capital T, but one could do the same if I had there a little t. Yeah, okay. Are there questions to this? So this really gives you somehow a basic idea how the stochastic integration works. Yeah, so you see the construction is very similar maybe to that of a Lebesgue integral, in the sense that we start with some piecewise constant processes. What is a non-trivial point is this progressive measurability, because that guarantees that the stochastic integral is a martingale. Yeah, so this is what we need there. So that's somehow the price we need to pay. Yeah, I cannot define a stochastic integral of something which is not progressively measurable, or at least not in this way. Yeah. So that's the price to pay. On the other hand, what we gain is really this Itô isometry, namely, kind of instead of doing some Helder inequality where I would only have an inequality, I really have an equality. And this is what also then pays off in the stochastic analysis. Yeah. Okay. But so far, everything was real valued. The Brownian motion was real valued. The stochastic process was also real valued. And so the question is how to extend this construction to several dimensions. And actually, it's really, there is no big surprise. It's really what you would expect. So I can define an m-dimensional Brownian motion, W1, Wm, which means that each of them is a real-valued Brownian motion, and they are mutually independent. So this is really that can be defined based on our previous definition. And now, what processes phi you would like to integrate? So generally, you could think somehow in terms of, let's say, matrix vector multiplication. So here I have m times 1, this will be my w, this will be my phi, and I could yes, so what I would like to have here is, let's say, n times m matrix, and then what I get here is a vector n times 1. Yeah, so that means now I would like to integrate actually matrix valued processes. Yeah, so that would mean that phi at time s is a mapping from omega and now to the matrices n times m. Yeah, but other than that, everything remains the same. So again, it should be progressively measurable, and again, this L2 condition should be there. I really write it even the same, where the modulus here means the Euclidean norm in this matrix space, in this, yeah, in R, n times m. And under those conditions, again, I can approximate by elementary processes, and I get the Itô isometry, and everything really works in a very consistent way. Yeah, so this is what you can probably somehow believe. And I don't have much time now anymore. I will continue tomorrow. So the next question that I would like to discuss is, well, maybe we don't want to stay in a finite dimension. Maybe I would like to have here a Brownian motion which is infinite dimensional. So really a sequence of Brownian motions. Yeah. In other words, I would like to think of W, which is a U-valued Brownian motion. So it takes values in some Hilbert space. And then again, the question is, what is the process phi? Yeah, and somehow I would like to have it in the space of linear operators from U to some separable Hilbert space U, H, sorry. Yeah, and I will discuss tomorrow how to do this precisely. So if you want to be in the infinite dimension for some reason, you need that. Yeah, then it's not so trivial. So the extension to finite dimension but higher than one here, that's really very trivial from what we have learned over there. But here one needs again something more, yeah, because one needs to control some infinite sum and to work a little harder. So this is what I will discuss tomorrow, and thank you very much for your attention.